Hello everyone, this side is Sevadeep Singh and today we have Vineet Bhatia who is an advocate and a leading expert in GST field. So we are here to take his views on how to file appeals under GST. Welcome sir.
Thank you.
Sir, first question is, who can file an appeal under GST?
You see, the filing of appeals under GST is governed by section 107 of the CGST Act. And this act says that any person aggrieved by any order or decision passed by an adjudicating authority can file an appeal. So the scope for filing of appeal is very wide and it can be filed against a decision as well as against an order.
So you mentioned that appeal can be filed by any aggrieved person. So can you enlighten what aggrieved person here means?
You see, aggrieved person means somebody who is directly affected by the decision or the order. So what it implies is that a third party cannot file an appeal. Say for example, I'll give you an example. Say for example, I issue an invoice to you and due to some reason you are not eligible or you are not able to claim the input tax credit of that particular invoice because of certain defects in the invoice. And due to this reason, you deduct the amount which you are required to pay to me. Now, the question is, can I file an appeal stating that Mr. Vardeep should be allowed the credit for this invoice? The answer is no. In fact, a similar issue came up in the erstwhile regime, excise regime, in the case of where Hindustan Safety Glass Works Limited versus CCE. Where Hindustan Glass Safety Works had supplied certain things to Hindustan Motors Limited, but the driver lost the invoice and due to which they could not claim the credit. So Hindustan Safety Glass Works filed an appeal stating that Hindustan Motors Limited should be allowed to claim the credit on the basis of a duplicate invoice. So it was held that such an appeal is not maintainable. So aggrieved person would be only that person who is directly affected by an order or decision.
Okay. So next question comes, who is an adjudicating authority?
You see, the term adjudicating authority as well as the appellate authority, both these terms have been definitely defined in the CGST Act itself. Section 2, subsection 4 of the CGST Act defines adjudicating authority. So adjudicating authority, the definition says that any officer who is appointed under this act to and who is competent to pass any orders or decision would be an adjudicating authority. But it would not include the Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs, the Revisional Authority, the Authority for Advance Ruling, the Appellate Authority for Advance Ruling, the Appellate Authority, the Appellate Tribunal, and the Anti-Profiteering Authority. These will not fall within the definition of adjudicating authority. We have to keep one thing in mind that in GST, adjudicating authority has to be distinct from the appellate authority. A same authority cannot function both as adjudicating authority as well as adjudicating as well as appellate authority. So one may have to keep this thing in mind.
Okay, so you mentioned that Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs, Revisional Authority, Authority for Advance Ruling would be excluded in the definition of adjudicating, would be excluded in the definition of adjudicating authority. So what is the way to, if there is no way to file an appeal, so how an aggrieved person should move in case he has to go against their order?
You see, the orders by the Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs or the authorities which are mentioned, these orders are not non-appealable orders. So if you want to file an appeal against an order by CBIC, then you will have to challenge it by way of a writ petition in a court. As far as the Authority for Advance Ruling is concerned, for that there is a separate independent appellate authority which is Appellate Authority for Advance Ruling. So for the rest of the orders, like for if an order is passed by anti-profiteering authority, against that there is no appeal provided. So for that, you will have to challenge that order by way of a writ petition in High Court.
So the next question comes, can the department file an appeal against order passed by its own adjudicating authority?
Yes. In GST regime, this is a departure from the earlier tax regimes. In GST regime, the department can also file an appeal against the orders of its own adjudicating authority. So the commissioner can file an appeal against the orders of an adjudicating authority before the commissioner appeals. So first appeal can be filed by the department also under section 107 subsection 2 of the CGST Act.
And what is the time limit for filing an appeal?
The time limit for filing of an appeal is, if the appeal is being filed by an appellant, by an assessee, then in that case the appeal is to be filed within a period of 3 months from the date of communication of the order. And in case the appeal is being filed by the department, then this time limit is 6 months from the date of receipt of order.
Sir, what about condemnation if I am not able to file the appeal in time? So
yes, there is a provision in law whereby the appellate authority has been granted the powers to condone the delay in filing of the appeal, but that is subject to a maximum of 1 month. So in case of appeal filed by the assessee, the appellate authority can condone it by 1 month, and similarly for an appeal filed by the department, the delay can be condoned by 1 month. After that, the appellate authority becomes functus officio and cannot condone the delay in filing of the appeal. So we have to be very, very careful while we are computing the limitation period, and we must keep in mind that there is a time limit for filing of the appeal. And
sir,
this time period is to be reckoned from the date of receipt of the order, from the date of communication of the order to the party.
Sir, मान लो एक जेन्युइन केस है जिसमें एसएससी हॉस्पिटलाइज है एंड ही कैन नॉट फाइल इवन इन द कॉन्डोन पीरियड, इवन 1 month कॉन्डोन पीरियड एज वेल, तो कैन ही गो फॉर अपील इन एनी केस?
नो, देयर आर जजमेंट्स टू द इफेक्ट दैट दिस टाइम लिमिट, वेयर एवर देयर इज एन आउटर टाइम पीरियड प्रिस्क्राइब्ड, दैट टाइम पीरियड इज सैक्रोसैंक्ट and the appellate authority cannot condone the delay beyond the outer time limit prescribed under the statute. So one must keep this in mind.
So the next question, which is very important and many of my colleagues ask, how to draft an appeal?
You see, an appeal has to be filed online. Generally, if the order is online, then the appeal is also available on the has to be filed online on the common portal. The statutory form for filing an appeal is APL 01. While drafting an appeal, we have to take care of two, three things. A, the first point is, you have to very clearly state the statement of facts. You have to mention the facts in a very clear and unequivocal manner, so that when an officer or the appellate authority is reading the facts, he should know as to what is the transaction and what are the facts of your case. So you should very clearly state the facts of the case. That is point number one. Number two, you must find out, read the order very carefully, then read the law very carefully, and then draft the grounds of appeal. In the grounds of appeal, you must not just take one ground or two grounds. You must take all the possible grounds which you can take in an appeal. Few grounds which are standard and which should be taken in each and every appeal is, like, say for example, you must write in each and every appeal that the appellant craves the right or liberty, seeks liberty to add or alter any other ground of appeal. So by writing this, you reserve to yourself the right to add any other ground of appeal if by chance any ground gets missed. You must also, in the grounds of appeal, state the relevant statutory provisions. The statutory provisions should be reproduced in the appeal itself, so that if you don't have the statute with you, still you can refer the statutory provisions from the appeal itself. So the relevant act rules must be reproduced in the appeal itself. Then whatever case laws you want to rely upon must be stated in the appeal itself. But while stating, be very, very cautious. Just check whether that case law still holds the field or not, and whether it has been overruled or not. So you must keep in mind that you are quoting only those case laws which are relevant and which are up to the date. Thirdly, you must very clearly state in the appeal the relief which you want from the appellate authority. So the prayer clause should be very well drafted, and in the ground of appeal clause you must also keep in mind and point out the lacunas and the shortcomings in the order of the adjudicating authority, impugned order. And if you want to rely upon certain evidences which are not a part of the record, that also must be annexed along with the appeal. So the appeal should be a very well drafted appeal. Besides APL 01 and the entire appeal, there are certain documents which you must annex along with the appeal. One is a certified copy of the impugned order that has to be annexed, and a pre-deposit challan has to be annexed. So these are the documents which necessarily should accompany the appeal.
So you mentioned that you need to deposit a pre-deposit amount before filing an appeal. So what is the pre-deposit amount, and can a waiver be given in any case?
You see, in GST law, they have prescribed a pre-deposit amount, and in earlier laws, the pre-deposit amount was a precondition for entertainment of appeal. But in GST law, section 107, subsection 6 states that no appeal shall be filed unless and until the admitted tax is paid. So if you admit a certain tax, that tax has to be paid in full. So if you don't pay the tax, you cannot file an appeal. For the admitted portion of the tax has to be paid in full. And then besides this, you are also under an obligation to pay 10% of the disputed tax amount. So I am saying you have to pay 10% of the disputed tax amount, not of the interest and penalty component. Only 10% of the tax amount is to be paid when the appeal is being filed before the first appellate authority. When the appeal is being filed before the appellate tribunal, then 20% of the disputed amount is required to be paid.
So the next question is, you said 20% in case of appellate tribunal. So that 20% is 10 more percent, or 20% is 10 plus 20%?
You see, this dispute was there in service tax. If you remember, in service tax it was 7.5% and 10%. So the question arose whether this 10% is over and above 7.5%, or when I am filing an appeal before the tribunal, then only 2.5% is required to be deposited. So this question came up, and then the Delhi High Court decided and stated that when you are filing an appeal before the tribunal, then only 2.5% remaining is required to be paid. So the 10% is total 10%. But in GST law, it is not like this. They have very, very categorically stated in the act itself that 20% shall be besides the 10% amount already deposited by an appellant. So in GST, if you are filing an appeal before the tribunal, you have to pay additional 20% other than the 10% which you have already deposited.
Sir, regarding pre-deposit only, there is also one frequent question that whether DRC 03 challan, which is required for pre-deposit, can be paid through electronic credit ledger.
Yes, definitely it can be paid through electronic credit ledger. Credit is nothing else. You, as per section 49, you can make the payment of taxes through your credit ledger. So in my opinion, the DRC 03 challan, which is a pre-deposit amount, can be paid through the credit ledger.
सर इसमें एक प्रैक्टिकल डिफिकल्टी आती है या प्रैक्टिकल एक क्वेश्चन आता है. लेट सपोज मैंने 10% प्री डिपॉजिट अमाउंट जमा करा दिया. नाउ कैन जीएसटी ऑफिसर, कैन जीएसटी अथॉरिटी प्रोविजनली अटैच माई बैंक अकाउंट फॉर द नेक्स्ट 90% और कैन दे डिस्प्यूट फॉर द नेक्स्ट 90%?
You see, first of all, provisional attachment is done only before adjudication. So we should not say provisional attachment. Provisional attachment can be done only before adjudication. Once an adjudication is completed, it has to be recovery of demands. But law very categorically states that if a person has deposited 10% of the disputed amount, then the remaining amount shall be deemed to be stayed till the pendency of the proceedings before the appellate authority. So, in my opinion, the officer concerned cannot proceed to recover the balance amount if a person has filed an appeal and deposited 10% of the disputed amount.
So, sir, thank you so much for your time, for your knowledge. And we will definitely ask you more questions on appeals and revision under GST in the next video.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.